stares through my eyes in the yellow haze of the new rising sun. I recall the days when the feeling was warm.
All right, we're getting close to done on these optical selection videos. We're getting real close to actually applying some knowledge in physics and calculating firing solutions and things like that and doing some shooting. So we're getting real close here. Just maybe a couple more little videos on optics, because as we said before, optics, out of all your different equipment selection, that's the primary piece of equipment that is going to make or break the whole system. And it's usually the weak link in the chain. Inferior optics are going to totally render your $5,000 sniper rifle useless. Or the right optics could make a $100, like most at Nagant, very, very effective. So we want to be very sure that we're selecting all the right features on our long-range scope here. So let's briefly talk about reticles again. We talked about this on our videos before. But there's different types of reticles a guy can choose from when you're looking at long-range tactical scopes, because as we determined before, we're going to be looking for a long-range tactical scope with target turrets and a ranging reticle. Well, what kind of ranging reticle would be most appropriate for our purposes? We're going to look at mil-dot reticles, mil-scale reticles. We talked about the inappropriateness of BDC reticles for our purposes, the ballistic drop compensating reticles, and if you missed the videos before this one, you'll want to watch those for sure. The SVD type reticles can almost be categorized in with those BDCs. Then we have minute of angle scale reticles, which is just it's the equivalent of the mil dot or the mil scale. It's just in minutes of angle. And we talked about our angular systems of measurement in a couple videos ago, I think part 15 or something like that. And then you have your normal crosshairs and your duplex and speed dots, which we mentioned before are not going to be appropriate for our purposes. We're going to absolutely need angular systems of measurement marked off on our scope reticle so that we can apply different hold off, because there's more than just wind going on at extreme ranges and our firing solutions become extremely complex. And the more help we can get from a reticle, the better off we're going to be, especially when it comes to variables that can change on the fly. You can dial in your constants on your optic, on the turrets. For example, if you're shooting at stream range and you got Coriolis correction and a spin drift correction, those are going to be basically constant for that target range. So you can dial those in on your scope because they're not going to change. But the wind might be fluctuating. It usually fluctuates quite a bit. So that's something you might want to just hold off in your scope for. So that's why these ranging reticles are extremely important. They're not only just for ranging, but the mil dots or the MOA scale reticles, whatever you're using, you're gonna actually use that in your firing solution. It's not just for determining the distance to the target. And we'll talk about all those things in much greater detail pretty soon here. And there's lots of different types of reticles. Basically, in my experience, I would recommend reticles that are clean and simple. And the classic mil dot reticle is probably the best, actually. If you have too much going on in your reticle, there's some really neat designs out there, like the Horus reticle. It has kind of a grid network etched in the glass. And these are spaced apart just like a mil dot, how the mils are the dots are spaced 1 milliradian apart from each other. And that's the angular system of measurement. This is the same thing. It's usually in mils, and it just makes it a grid. And the idea is you take the first shot, and then you can see where you hit at whatever range on that grid, and then you just adjust to that spot on the grid, take your second shot, and you can get really, really close or right on. And that's a really good design, and it's great for a lot of purposes. But in real world applications at extreme range, it is extremely important that you make a solid first round hit. Because like we said before, if you're shooting at a mule deer buck stand in there at 1,000 meters, and you zing one over its head, it may very likely get spooked and start moving. Now your shot is going to be 10 times more difficult than it was when it was standing still. Moving targets at extreme range are extremely hard to shoot at. if you have a really distant ranges, sometimes you're shooting, you know, your time of flight on your bullets a couple seconds or more. So you're going to have to anticipate where the target's going to be. It's just too many variables. And basically, you're going to have one chance on a lot of these targets at long range, even for combat applications. Once a target knows that something's shooting at it, it's going to not want to stand there. So that fact kind of takes all the magic out of the reticles, like the Horus reticle, for our purposes. Now, it's good for a lot of different things, for target shooting and things like that, or even if, you know, in some designated marksman applications where you're in combat and there's a lot of rounds flying both directions, they're not going to be any more spooked from a second or a third or a 50th shot or a 1,000th shot, you know? So in those applications and where you're already engaged in a firefight or something for combat, the Horus reticle might be actually pretty handy because it'll take a lot of the guessing out of your holdover and a lot of your corrections and stuff like that. But actually, being honest, your brain is going to be able to basically draw up those grids by itself just by looking at the mil dots. So you're going to be able to interpret where those grids would have been. You can still do the same holdover and corrections using a mil dot reticle without the grid underneath it. So the Horus reticles are really cool. I thought that was a neat idea. But actually, in practice, if you have too busy of a reticle, that can be a problem. It can obscure targets. Your field of view will be a little more obscured by all that stuff going on in there. Also, it has a psychological effect to kind of fluster a guy in the field under pressure sometimes when you got a lot going on. Instinctively speaking, a mil dot reticle is symmetrically encompassing the crosshairs in the middle, which is very good in, psychologically speaking. If you're under pressure and you have to make some shots, it's not going to encourage you to aim somewhere else because it's all centered around that crosshairs. And that's why most of these crosshair designs are built like that. So I would recommend like just a straight mil dot scope. You can do the mil scale scopes too, like Schmidt and Bender PM2 offers, and a lot of different optics offer mil scale reticles. There's lots of different kinds. Some of them have numbers on them, some of them don't. But actually, I think the mil dots is just very intuitive the way they work. And when we get more into actually ranging using the mil dots in some of our later videos, you'll see what I'm talking about. But it's nice to have those little round dots because the eye can more easily divide those dots into different units of measurement than it can with a line. Sometimes just a bunch of lines on a reticle can, it's more hard to discern your different angular measurements there sometimes when you're doing real fine calculations and stuff. So if you decided to go with a minute of angle scale reticle, that's fine too. I don't know if they really offer a minute of angle dot reticle. I haven't seen one. That doesn't mean they don't exist, but those are going to be fine too. But just keep it simple as possible. Some of these have more mil dots extending down on the bottom crosshair, and that's actually a pretty good idea for some. Sometimes you might not have time to dope in your scope on the turret. And if you have more mil dots going vertically down, you're going to have a greater holdover before you have to start turning your turrets. So let's see here. And we also talked about, I need to reiterate this because this is absolutely important. Whatever reticle you have is going to be rendered absolutely useless if it's not in the first focal plane. Even if the scope is equipped with a marker or something that tells you, okay, you need to have it adjusted to 10 power or whatever magnification setting, you do not want a second focal plane scope with the ranging reticle, because even if you're set to where it's supposed to be, a tiny hair off in magnification is going to throw off your angular units of measurement by a lot. And it doesn't take very much at all at extreme ranges to miss by a lot. So absolutely must have your ranging reticle in the first focal plane for our applications. And that's talking about variable power scopes. If you have a fixed power scope, your magnification will not change. Therefore, your reticle will always be perfectly right on. So this does not apply to fixed power scopes. That doesn't matter. That's basically not applicable to those. So if you got a fixed scope, don't worry about your focal planes. It would not matter. But on scopes where the magnification value changes, it's extremely important because you want your mils to be spaced 1 mil apart, no matter what power setting you're on. You don't want your mils to be spaced like 0.378948 mils apart on a different power setting. That's going to be very confusing, and I've seen it throw some dudes off pretty bad. Okay, the next subject here is objective lenses, and I don't need to spend a lot of time on this, but generally speaking, the larger objective lens you have is going to be good for some things like light gathering. So if you want maximum light gathering, a larger objective lens will give that to you. Now, we're going to talk about quality of lenses here on the later in this video or on the next video. So there are going to be some smaller objective lenses that are higher quality that are going to outperform a very, very large objective lens of a lower quality. A huge part of light gathering and optical clarity has to do with the quality of the glass. But all things being equal, general quality and, manufacture and all that stuff being equal, a larger objective lens will have better light gathering. However, for certain applications, like particularly combat, larger objective lenses do have reflectivity and glare issues. And you probably know what I'm talking about. You don't want your scope glinting at the enemy, giving away your location. That's what happened to that North Vietnamese Cobra sniper there. That's what killed him. Carlos Hathcock saw his scope shining and he was able to send a round right through the tube of his scope and got him. So that's a bad deal if you're in tactical applications. You don't want to give away your position. So there are things you can do, anti-reflective devices, and we'll talk about those in peripheral equipment selection. That'll basically take the glare out of your objective lens, and those do work pretty good. But there again, if you have to use one of those devices, you're going to erase quite a bit of optical clarity and light gathering. So it kind of defeats the purpose of having a giant objective lens if you're just going to cover it up with an anti-reflective device. If you look at most militaries that use optical sights for their sniper rifles, you'll see that the popular objective lens size is about in the 40 millimeter, you know, like 42 millimeter, 44 millimeter, 40 millimeter objective lenses. And that's usually plenty. So you don't need to go a lot bigger than that. There are reasons why a guy would want to go bigger, but you don't need to. Like we talked about before, objective lens is part of the equation for calculating exit pupil diameter. Exit pupil diameter is how large the image is that's going to be projected on your eye. If you want that image to look huge and full when you put your eye behind the scope, you want a larger objective lens and a lower magnification setting. Basically, your exit pupil diameter in millimeters, that's the size of the image that's going to be projected on your eye, is your objective lens divided by your magnification. So larger lenses and smaller magnification will give you a larger exit pupil diameter, which can make it easier also to get behind the scope and actually see something. You don't have to be as perfectly centered in order to get a full field of view. So if you're really having to make a quick shot or something or bring up the rifle, that'll help you there. Now, as we talked about before, we don't want to encourage that. That will change your point of impact a lot of times if your parallax ain't adjusted perfectly. So you do always want to be perfectly centered behind the optic. But exit pupil diameter is still kind of a nice thing to have. And if you've ever looked through a scope like my Schmidt & Bender with the 56 millimeter objective lens, that's pretty big, actually. 56 is pretty huge. And when I have that thing set to 10 even 10 power, just because you got to look at the equation, you know, it's still a really nice large field, really nice large exit pupil, and the image is just nice and full. So that's a real nice thing about a larger objective lens. Other than that, if you're really planning on using this rifle for serious business, like combat or something like that, you don't want too large of an objective lens for the reasons we discussed. So if someone had to ask me, just in generally speaking, you know, what objective lens size is the best, I would say 40 millimeters totally adequate. Maybe a little bigger is fine. Certain applications, you don't want it too big, but it's going to be your glass quality that really determines your light gathering and your optical clarity. So I would recommend focusing on glass quality rather than objective lens size. A lot of cheap scopes try to make up for really poor lens quality by making really large lenses to try to make it seem like it's higher quality. But if you ever get a chance to pick up a real, real premium optic, even with the smaller objective lens, you'll know what I'm talking about, that the higher quality lens is going to be the one with the most optical clarity, not the largest one. Okay, that finishes up our part of this video on sight features. We're talking about long-range optical sight parameters. The first big chunk of that was optical sight features. And then we talked about tracking, turret types, tube diameter magnification, and all that stuff, and reticles, and we just finished that up. The other half of a long-range optical sight parameters we're going to discuss is sight quality. Now that we talked about all the different features scopes can have, we didn't talk about the quality of those features. And this is just as important as the features. Now, you got to have the right features in your long-range scope or it's not going to work. And those features that you have must actually work. So now let's talk about sight quality. So on the next video here, we're going to talk about turret adjustment drums, erector assembly quality, glass quality. You guys are going to like this one. We're going to talk about the different glass types. What's APO glass? What's that ED glass? You know, a lot of guys talk about HD glass. What is that, high definition like on your TV screen? Not really. But we'll discuss that in detail. I'll show you some diagrams of how these different lenses are constructed so you understand what's going on. We're going to talk about reticle quality very briefly and then overall construction quality. And we will apply this to brand names. And then when all is said and done, we're going to actually look at a whole bunch of different manufacturers of scopes and different models, and we're going to go through some optic selection, very similar to like what we did in our cartridge selection video. If you remember that video, we're going to systematically break this down, and we're going to scientifically determine which of these different optics are going to be the most appropriate for your application. We're going to erase the emotion factor out of the equation, and we're not going to pay any attention to my uncle told me factor out of the equation. We're not going to give you too much opinion. I hate trying to give you guys my opinion because that's objective from my experience. But if I just lay out all these different facts and then we can systematically eliminate things that are not appropriate for us, that should give you a real good understanding of scopes. And when we're all done with this part of the video, you should have a very good knowledge of long-range optical sight parameters to where you can just look at any different model at a glance and really determine how appropriate it's going to be for your long-range purposes. All right, so stick around. Our next video is on sight quality.